This video is made possible by Maiden. Get 15% off of your first order for any cookware you want by following the link down in the description. All right, here's a question for all you geography nerds. What is the longest river in the world? Is it A, the Nile in Africa, B, the Amazon in South America, C, the Yangtze in Asia, or D, the Mississippi in North America? That seems like a pretty simple enough question, right? If you don't know off the top of your head, well then maybe you end up just searching on Wikipedia and you come across this list, which says that the Nile is the world's longest. Boom, end of video. The only problem with that is that if your friend searches on Google, what is the world's longest river? Google will tell them that the Amazon is the world's longest river instead. Huh. And if you search on Guinness World Records or NASA, they'll both tell you that the Nile is the world's longest. But if you visit the History Channel's website, they'll tell you that it's, quote, likely the Amazon. So, what's going on here? Depending on who the person was that was asking you that question in the first place, the correct answer could have either been option A or option B, and the reason is because, well, there isn't any real clear scientific way to actually tell which river is longer or shorter than the other. And this is why. Let's say that you have this river that you want to measure. It might seem to you as simple as finding where it starts and where it ends, and then just measuring the length in between. But it's really vastly more complicated than that. Let's take the Mississippi River in North America as a neutral example. The traditional starting point, or the source for the river, is up in Itasca, Minnesota, while the traditional endpoint, or mouth, is down at the Gulf of Mexico and just past New Orleans. This makes the Mississippi the second longest river in America. But there are dozens and dozens of other rivers and streams that flow into the Mississippi at various other different points and from various other origin locations. These are called tributaries, and one of them that flows into the Mississippi is the Missouri River, while another that flows into the Missouri is called the Jefferson River. If you consider both of these as mere parts of the greater Mississippi River, well, then you've just gone and tripled the Mississippi's total length. Although it still doesn't even get as long as either the Nile or the Amazon. In addition to that, the river's actual mouth or endpoint can be pretty arbitrarily decided upon as well. Because when you're talking about the Mississippi, where exactly do you decide to draw the line? Would it be here, here, or here? Each option has a different length. And further, rivers change their course all the time, over a period of decades and centuries, which also can obviously change their lengths over time. But there's many, many more problems that go from there. Let's take this river as a hypothetical example, and then you need to imagine that I'm a cruel geography teacher telling you to measure its length. Theoretically, you have a few different options at your disposal to do that, but all of them are equally correct and also incorrect at the same time. You could simply measure using a straight line from the source to the mouth and come up with an answer of about 300 kilometers. But that wouldn't really take into account all of the river's various curves and bends, so it's not really an accurate measurement of the river's total length. If you want to measure the full length, including all of the curves, then you've got to use a smaller unit of measurement broken up into smaller chunks, like, let's say, units of 50 kilometers. In this instance, you use 13 of these 50-kilometer blocks, and you come up with a length of 650 kilometers. But then, if you shorten the measuring blocks down to 10 kilometers, you may end up using 75 of them, and then come up with an answer measuring 750 kilometers instead. By simply reducing the unit of measurement that you were using, you came up with an answer that was 100 kilometers longer. And the smaller and smaller you make your measuring units, the longer the answer you're going to end up getting. Eventually, you can approach the molecular level for your measuring units, and the answer for the river's length will end up approaching infinity. So depending on what you used, your answer for the length of this river could range anywhere from 300 kilometers to infinity. And you can kind of, sort of, justify any of them. Although, the further ends of this spectrum are a lot shakier than others. In mathematics, this is because of a concept known as fractals. And it's also why it's pretty much impossible to ever come to a consensus on the length of any country's coastline. Because every landmass is irregularly shaped, like fractals are. So, when you're measuring the length of a river, it's important to not only define where the beginning and endpoints are, but to also define what units of measurement you're actively using. Alright, so let's hop over to the Nile and the Amazon and see what all the controversy between them is all about. We're gonna begin with the Nile and start off with some history. For thousands of years now, the Nile has been one of the most important rivers in the world for human civilization. Its course through the Sahara Desert brings luscious life and rich agricultural farmland throughout an otherwise barren and inhospitable desert. The banks of the Nile was the genesis for ancient Egypt and was considered to be the primary breadbasket of the Roman Empire centuries later. Even today, 95% of modern Egypt's entire population of more than 100 million people live within close proximity of the Nile's banks, making it one of the most densely populated areas on the planet that can be easily seen from space. But despite this massive historical importance going back literally thousands of years, the Nile's actual source was one of humanity's greatest mysteries for thousands of years. Countless expeditions over the eons were made to find it, including an expedition organized by the Roman Emperor Nero around 61 AD that may have potentially made it as far south as the Murchison Falls in Uganda before encountering too many difficulties and returning home. The Americas and the Amazon River were discovered by Europeans long before the source of the Nile ever was. It wasn't even until the 16th century when European explorers discovered that the Nile actually splits into two at the Sudanese capital city of Khartoum. These streams became known as the Blue Nile and the White Nile, and by 1618, Spanish missionaries had finally discovered the source of the Blue Nile down at Lake Tana in the highlands of Ethiopia. However, the source of the White Nile remained an elusive mystery for centuries more to come. By the mid-19th century, pretty much everybody in the world accepted that the Amazon was the undisputed world's longest river. An atlas published back in 1846 gave the Amazon a length of 3,200 miles, and placed the Nile in second with a length that was 500 miles shorter. But the Western world's fog of discovery over the African interior was finally, after thousands of years, beginning to fade away, and in 1858, British explorers finally trekked down far enough to discover the White Nile source at Lake Victoria in Uganda. To the west, a 4,000-year-long mystery had finally just been solved, and in 1864, mapmakers measured the length of the Nile as originating here at the tip of Lake Victoria and flowing up to its mouth in the Mediterranean Sea past Alexandria. But this length was controversial. As the knowledge around the area of Lake Victoria expanded, this distance was also expanded by measuring the length of the river as beginning on the opposite side of Lake Victoria where the water is furthest from the river's mouth up north, which could be measured either by a straight line directly across the lake or by a longer curve around the lake's shoreline and then towards the river. And then it was even further discovered that there are multiple rivers around Lake Victoria which feed it, the longest of which was determined to be the nearly 600-kilometer-long Kagera River, which begins in Rwanda. So, if you measure the Nile out as beginning here in Rwanda and then follow along the Kagera, and then measure out around the shoreline of Lake Victoria, before measuring the White Nile up to the full Nile, and then from there up to the Mediterranean, you get a final length of about 6,650 kilometers and the world's longest river. Okay, now let's move over to the Amazon. First of all, saying that the Amazon is all just one large river is really a huge misnomer, because it's really all a completely gargantuan network of tributaries that are all connected over time, forming what is absolutely and undisputedly the largest river in terms of total water volume in the world. The sheer scale of the Amazon River system is difficult to comprehend. But I'll put it this way, 20% of all the Earth's freshwater that is entering the oceans comes from just the Amazon system alone. That is more water than the Nile, Congo, Ganges, Yangtze, St. Lawrence, Mississippi, Mekong, Volga, Danube, and Rhine rivers all combined. By a long shot, the Amazon's river basin is the largest in the world, and it's so big it could almost be considered an entire continent in its own right were it not attached to the rest of South America. As it stands, the basin covers nearly 40% of the entire South American continent, and it could swallow the entirety of France inside of it more than 11 times over. The first European explorer to have produced a map of the river was a Czech missionary back in 1689 named Samuel Fritz. whose map is actually shockingly accurate even when compared with maps that are produced today. As time continued across the 17th, 18th, and 19th centuries, the Amazon River and the basin surrounding it continued to be explored more and more until it was eventually determined that there are more than 1,100 different tributaries that fed into the primary river. For many years, the furthest away source for the Amazon was believed to be the Apurimac River in the Andes Mountains of southern Peru, which from there to the river's mouth over on the other side of Brazil in the Atlantic gave it a traditional length of about 6,400 kilometers. Until the discovery of the Kagera River in Rwanda, this made the Amazon the world's longest known river. But after the Kagera was discovered, the Nile's official measurement placed it just 250 kilometers, or only 4% longer than the Amazon. For decades, the Nile was widely considered and accepted by almost everyone to be the longer of the two rivers, but evidently, the Brazilian government wasn't ready to concede the title to the Nile and to Egypt just yet. For decades, the Apurimac River was considered to be the tributary river that was furthest away from the Amazon's mouth in the Atlantic. But that was until 2014, when a new group of researchers studied another tributary river nearby called the Rio Montaro, and discovered that it was nearly 80 kilometers longer than the Apurimac. So from here, the Rio Montaro eventually converges with the Apurimac to form the Ene River, which eventually converges with the Parin River to form the Tambo River, which itself eventually converges with the Urubamba River to form the Ucayali River, which itself eventually converges with the Maranhão River, where it finally becomes the main Amazon River. So this is basically a tributary of a tributary of a tributary of yet another tributary that finally flows directly into the Amazon. But 80 kilometers all on its own doesn't make up for the fact that the Nile was still placed at 250 kilometers longer. So to make up the remaining 170 kilometers, the researchers also revised their estimate for the Amazon's endpoint as well. Traditionally, the Amazon's mouth was always believed to be located here on the north side of Marajó Island, at one of two possible mouth locations. But these researchers decided to use the southern route, which exits out along and past the southern side of Marajó Island, which adds an additional 353 kilometers in total length to the Amazon. For these reasons, this research team concluded that the Amazon's total length is actually, in fact, 6,992 kilometers, which beats out the traditional measurement of the Nile by 342 kilometers. But to be fair to the Nile, this same research team applied similar methodologies to measure the Nile as well and found that it was actually 6,953 kilometers, which makes the Amazon about 140 kilometers longer, according to their research. It might be a little bit of a stretch, and the team conducting the research may have been from the Brazilian Institute of Geography and Statistics, but that didn't stop the government of Brazil from immediately embracing these new measurements and citing that they are, in fact, the true owners of the world's longest river. So, yeah, the lesson here is that measuring things is probably more complicated than you thought it was. But, to be fair, there's a lot of things that seem pretty complicated, but they often don't really have to be. Take cooking, for example. My least favorite part about cooking always used to be the prep. Dicing vegetables, mincing garlic, trimming meat, anything that had to do with a knife. But I never realized until recently that my problem wasn't so much with cutting, but with simply using knives that weren't very high quality. So I went ahead and I bought myself this, the chef's knife from Made In. This is the sharpest knife I've ever opened from a box, and I used it right away to start dicing up some Brussels sprouts. Got a little too close with my finger and quickly discovered why the box included a Band-Aid. It didn't include 5 Band-Aids. There's 5 here because I actually bought 5 knives from Made In that all serve a different and important purpose in my kitchen. I think my favorite little touch from each of these, though, are the little paper blueprints and instruction guides that come with each of them. Coming from someone who didn't really have a lot of knowledge when it came to cooking before I started using them, I really, really appreciated these a lot. But the thing I love the most about Made In is that they source only the finest materials, and they partner with world-renowned craftsmen to make these kitchen tools and bring them straight to you, all without the markup. So rather than buying a $20 knife that's going to break or rust and force you to buy another one the next year, you should invest in one that's made for life and backed up by a lifetime guarantee. It'll also make cooking for you easy, fun, and most importantly, fast. And the same goes for their pots, pans, bakeware, plates, and everything else Maiden sells for your kitchen. It's all super high quality, durable, and legitimately used by professionals across the world. Best of all, now is the best time to invest in your kitchen, because Maiden is offering Real Life Lore viewers 15% off of your first order with them. The best discount available anywhere, which you can get by clicking the button that's on your screen right now, which will take you directly to maidencookware.com/RLL and then use the promo code RLL. And as always, thank you so much for watching.